The Shop That Never Was, written by Herbert George Wells. The Shop That Never Was is an adaptation from his famous short story, The Magic Shop. I had seen The Magic Shop from afar several times. I had passed it once or twice, but never had I thought of going in. One day my son Gib dragged me up to the shop. There was such keenness in him that I was forced to get in. It was a little narrow shop, not very well lit. On the shop counter there were several crystal balls. On the floor there were magic mirrors, one to draw you out long and thin and one to make you short and fat. While we were laughing at all this, the shopman appeared. "How can I help you?" said he. "I want to buy my little boy a few simple tricks," I said. "Hmm," said the shopman and scratched his head for a moment, as if thinking. Then he drew from his hair a glass ball and said something like this and held it out. The action was unexpected. I had seen the trick done at magic shows, but I had not expected it here. "That's good," I said with a laugh. "Is not it?" said the shopman. Gib stretched out his hand to take this object and found merely a blank palm. "It is in your pocket," said the shopman, and there it was. "How much does it cost?" I asked. "There is no charge for glass balls," said the shopman politely. "We get them free." He drew a business card from his cheek and handed it to me. "Genuine magic goods, sir," he said. He now turned towards Gib with a friendly smile and said, "You wanted a magic box, did not you?" "Yes," Gib said. "It is in your pocket," he said. Gib discovered the box with surprise. Then the shopman quickly went behind the counter and was absent for a while. "Let's look behind the counter, Gib," I said. "He's making fun of us." Just then he appeared again from a dark corner of the room. "You did like to see our showroom, sir," said he. Gib tugged my finger forward. In the showroom there were many things that Gib fancied. He turned to this astonishing man with respect. "Is that a magic sword?" he said. "A magic toy sword. This is a unique one. It neither bends, breaks, nor cuts the fingers," replied the shopman. "I tried to find out what they cost, but the shopman did not pay attention to me. He had got Gib now." I saw with a feeling of distrust that Gib was holding this person's finger as usually he held mine. The shopman showed Gib magic trains that ran without steam, clockwork, and a box of soldiers that all came alive when one said a magic word. "You have never seen such a one," said the shopman. "You will take that box?" "We will take that box," I said. And the shopman swept the soldiers back again, shut the lid and waved the box in the air. And there it was in brown paper tied up and with Gib's full name and address on the paper. He laughed at my amazement. I felt very uneasy and began to look for the way out. Turning to Gib, I saw him standing on a stool. The shopman was holding a big drum in his hand. "We're playing hide and seek, Teddy," cried Gib. And before I could prevent him, the shopman had put the big drum over him. "Take that off," I cried. "This instant, you will frighten the boy." The shopman did so without a word. He held the big drum towards me to show its emptiness. The stool was empty too. My boy had disappeared. "Where is my boy?" I said. "You see," he said, displaying the drum's interior, "this is genuine magic." I jumped at him and fell into utter darkness. Third. "Sorry, sir, I did not see you coming," someone called. I saw I was in Regent Street and I had collided with a man, and a yard away was Gib. He was carrying four parcels in his arm. He smiled at me. He did not look scared. For a second I was at a loss. I started round to see the door of the magic shop. It was not there. There was no door, no shop, nothing. I did the only thing possible in that mental state. I called for a cab. I got in with Gib. "Dad," said Gib at last, "that was a proper magic shop." Gib looked completely undamaged. He was neither scared